Can you turn down your cell phones off or to vibrate? We're going to get started here. I would like to call the Hammond Redevelopment Commission meeting to order on this Tuesday, November 18th, 2014. It is now 4:33. Can you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence?
I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Do we have a roll call on the commissioners, please?
So, Presley?
Here.
Asbury?
Here.
Vivas?
Here.
Myricks?
Here.
Aldridge?
Here. We have five present, no absent. Declaration of Conflict of Interest. Okay, number four, Communications.
None were received.
Okay, number five, Homebound Conditional Forgivable Loan Approval.
Commissioners, out of the seven applicants, Ms. Marissa Hernandez and Francisco Hernandez both withdrew from the program. And out of the five that's remaining, three are here. So we can take those up now, or if you want to give the other applicants a little time to come, it's up to you.
I think we should give them a little bit of time and come back.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, that's fine. We will move on to number six and come back to that. Number six is a subordination request approval.
Commissioners, Mr. Frank Casera at 1639 172nd Street could not be here today, but he's just requesting a subordination agreement. His current loan is at $751.88 at 8%, and it's going down to $673.82 at 3.5%.
Yeah, I was looking at that. I was like, man, how did he get a 4.5% rate reduction?
It's
for him to tell me what he did.
He's not
here.
No.
Does he need to be here for our approval, or what is the requirement for this request?
Well, normally what we do in situations like this, we are okay, but with the condition that he comes back to the next week.
We can definitely ask him to come back to another meeting.
Mr. President.
Mr. Myricks.
I make a motion to approve the subordination request for Mr. Frank, how you say his last name again? Casera at 1639 172nd Street, and we would just ask that he would appear at one of our next meetings, because it's a simple, just a reduction in his mortgage rate. So he's not getting any cash out. So
right.
I don't see it being an issue.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion on that? Okay, can we have a roll call then, please?
So, Presley?
Yes.
Asbury?
Yes.
Vivas?
Yes.
Myricks?
Yes.
Aldridge?
Yes. Motion passes 5 yes. Okay, we have our special guest tonight, our Honorary Mayor McDermott Jr. is here. I'm going to ask him to come forward here. And
thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for letting me come out and speak to the Redevelopment Commission. It's been a while since I've been here. I just wanted to come out and thank you all for your service and talk a little bit about some big picture items that we have, with a lot of hard work from everybody that's in this room right now. We have a lot of really good things happening right now, and I just wanted to come in here and say thanks and sort of brief you all on what you know is happening and sort of give you our perspective from, the second floor of City Hall. But as everybody knows right now, we're in the process of moving planning and development staff from Conkey Street, where it's been located for years and years, into the City Hall building. I know we've been successful so far with a lot of the transfer of the employees, and I know there's still a few remaining employees out, but one of the good things about this move is because of, we're vacating the complex on Conkey, and we leased it out to a new development that's coming in, Root Brothers, which is a company, a third-generation, 88-year-old Illinois company that's coming into the building. It's 50 employees total at the new Hammond location. They're going to be hiring 30 to 40 new employees, so they're bringing 50 over, hiring 30 to 40 new employees, and obviously, we're always big about Hammond residents. They're taking an 80,000-square-foot building and making it, you know, productive on the tax rolls, and it's going to be opening in early 2015. Part of the reason we got that done, obviously, is because of the hard work you all did here. I know Phil Talon would be here, except for they just had a baby, and I wanted to congratulate him, and I know everybody's probably already said that by now, but a lot of hard work in this room to help make this happen. You know, on the outskirts of the city, it seems like we get the most interest on the outskirts of the city, but it's the internal parts of the city, it's harder to develop, and Root Brothers is a real positive because it's in the heart of Hammond, and it's harder to develop in the heart of the city than it is on the outskirts. So Root Brothers is a real positive thing, and I think having planning and development located in City Hall is a good idea also. It's always good when everybody's under the same roof. You know, for instance, I needed something today, and Africa was right here, and she helped me out, and actually, a lot of what I'm talking to you about right now is prepared by Africa, so I wanted to say thank you to her for that as well. But, you know, right now, when I took over as mayor, it's hard to believe it's been 11 years, but it has been 11 years, and when I took over, I needed the Redevelopment Commission's help on a big project we had in River Park Apartments. We call it Oxbow Landing now, but that was a major problem when I took over as mayor. We had a lot of bad things happen in that complex. It gave our city a bad image. We had a lot of calls for service in that area, and it was just a high-profile area that wasn't being used the right way, and working with your commission, working with, you know, a lot of the expertise in this room, we purchased the property, settled a lot of lawsuits, and went through a recession as property owners of a property that wasn't developing. Recently, we've worked real close with NDOT and got NDOT's permission to take down the sound walls, and because we're taking down the sound walls, all of a sudden, the visibility is a lot higher on that development, and now that the visibility is a lot higher, we're starting to land businesses. As we all know, we're opening Buffalo Wild Wings. The first business to open in that development is opening on Friday with the VIP reception. We know that we broke ground on a Hampton Inn, which is the Buffalo Wild Wings, a $20 million investment. Soft opening is this week. Hampton Inn, $12.5 million investment. It's going to be a 117-room hotel located right in there in the development. BW3s and Hampton Inn together is a $15 million reinvestment back into Oxbow Landing. I mean, when you think about, we bought the property for $14 million. If I remember my numbers correctly, Dave, you were our attorney at that time. It was about $14 million for the land. We settled lawsuits for a few million, and then we had to do demo and stuff like that. So when you think about, for $20 million, we acquired this property and got rid of a major problem in our city, and here we are, we've already landed $15 million in reinvestment back into the property, and we got a lot of property left. A lot of good news on Oxbow Landing. I think over the next term, we're going to see that fill. I think over the next year, we're going to see it filling up. And, you know, I know that you guys are going to be talking about a brewery that I don't want to say we stole from another community, but they were going to go to another community before they found out about the opportunity they had available here in Hammond, which is a $2.35 million investment, 13 to 15 employees initially, growing to 40 to 50 employees in the future, 12,000-square-foot building, a brew pub with a restaurant. So we got two great restaurants, a brand-new hotel, and we still have room to grow. Things are going really well at Oxbow Landing, and it's neat as mayor to see it happen because when we took over, it was a problem, and now it's an asset, and it's good. Right down the street over at Cabela's, another problem, you know, I mean, not problem, but another stalled development for a long time. It seems like it's catching fire now. We have a super Walmart that's literally under construction. I guess it's going to be open shortly after the holidays. Cabela's was a couple years ago, Cabela's Retail Store of the Year. That development's going to be successful. I know across the street, Interstate Plaza, we're getting a lot of real positive interest. Up on the north side, we have the development around the marina, which is, you know, I know the Redevelopment Commission helped us a lot with that, and that's also another area where we're going to see a lot of investments with restaurants and things of that nature tapping into the Illinois market. But it just seems to me like you know, first off, you guys are doing a great job and you're helping us out so much, but it seems like a lot of really good things are happening. And, you know, I know this is Wally's second meeting. I want to welcome you to the Redevelopment Commission. I really, you know, I'm not just saying it because I'm standing before you. This is literally one of the most important commissions we have in the city, because every development we do comes through you. So for the people that have been here for years and years, I want to thank you. To the staff, I want to thank you as well. And Awana and Phil and Africa and Brian do a great job. So I'm here to answer any questions you have also. It's been a while, like I said, since I've been here, so I wanted to come out and just make myself available if you have any questions and say thank you for your service, so.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
I don't have any questions, but
thanks,
I noticed today when I was on 94 that those sound walls have come down.
Yes, sir.
And I know that's something we've been working with for a while.
It's amazing how close BW3s is, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is.
I was talking with Attorney Westland before the meeting. He said it looks like you can throw a rock and hit it.
Yeah, it's very visible, so it's a good thing.
Yeah, I mean, we're not going to do that, but you could if you wanted to. Well, some people have stronger arms than others, but no. But no, it's, you know, and the thing is, as happy as we are with the edges of our city developing, because they are, the edges of our city, we have a lot of interest, but it gets harder and harder the more we go into it. And you only have to drive about a half a mile from where I live to see one of our, you know, one of our developments that hasn't gone as well is the Woodmar Mall, which is something that I try not to ever say myself. I brought it up myself this time. It's a question I get asked all the time. You know, people remember going to Woodmar Mall and having a good time at the mall, and people still go to Carson's and shop there and they want to know answers. And I know it's not for a lack of trying. I know there's a lot of reasons involved why that project hasn't moved forward. You know, one of them is because of its location. It's harder and harder to develop the further and further you go in the city. Mm-hmm. And you take Woodmar Mall and the challenges it poses there with basically steel mills across the street and a recycling plant across the street. And it's not an ideal location for big box retail outlets. You know, and that's one of our challenges. And this is an old city, and you know, that's the way old cities are. So you got to play the hands you're dealt. And this is our hand, and it's a good hand, by the way. But I'm excited. I think we're going to have a really good year. I think we're going to have a really good future in our city. I'm excited to be the mayor. And we have a lot of good things happening that help us out in redevelopment. One of the things that's really going well for us is what's happening with the water department and our water sales in Illinois. It's real exciting. It's Hammond's, a lot of people focus on the gaming revenue and how the gaming revenue has been dropping. It has, and it's for a number of reasons. People don't gamble as much because of the economy. There's more competition with casinos. There is. We have a brand new casino, well, not brand new anymore, a few years ago, opened up by O'Hare, took a big chunk out of gaming revenue in Hammond. And now in Illinois, you know, they haven't even opened this outside casino yet, and it hasn't been approved yet, but it's going to happen eventually. And Chicago's going to open a casino, and it's going to happen eventually. But what happened already is something that's really hit the bottom line with us is the gambling in the restaurants and the gambling in the grocery stores that they're doing in Illinois right now. You could go shopping and hit the slot machines before you want to go shopping. I mean, it's so, you know, gambling, when people talk about gambling and they focus on gambling, gambling's been good to our city. The gaming boats have been great to our city, but that revenue is going this way and water is going the other way. And for us, where we're situated, right on the border between Illinois and Indiana, we're the only water utility that could sell to Chicago, Hammond Water Company. And what we've done is guaranteed in contracts that we're the cheapest alternative to Mayor Rahm and the Chicago Water Company. And it's getting us a lot of business. And it's good business. It's the kind of thing that could really make up for the loss of our gaming revenue. So I'm excited about being mayor. I think I got a great staff in place. I want to thank everybody again, the Redevelopment Commission. One project, I see that a very good friend of mine, Jim Weezer and Justin Murphy, two good friends of mine sitting behind me, there's a project that's happening in Hessville that we're real excited about also. It has to do with the rail development, and it's a huge potential for us to take what has been unproductive land for a long time and make it, you know, convert it into investment into our city, create more jobs, more warehousing opportunities, and it's located right off of, you know, Klein Avenue, right off of Michigan and Klein there. So you got quick access to the toll road, quick access to the highway. It's a, you know, it just seems like there's a lot of good things happening. You know, potash is underway. Finally, thank goodness. But you know, the potash development's not hurting things either. So just seems like we got a lot of real positive momentum, and I just want to come out here and say thanks. So any other questions?
I just like to
comment.
The mayor's right. It is a great corridor there in our city, the Oxbow Landing that you mentioned. And I just really appreciate you coming out tonight and giving us the information and the update.
Thanks, Tony. You know, I wanted to cover one more thing before I relinquish the microphone. I've been hearing a lot lately about certain parts of the city aren't getting developed as fast as others, and, you know, I'm the mayor of the whole city. I'm not the mayor of the edges of the city. I'm the mayor of the whole city. And, you know, I do understand, and in particular, the councilman from the third district has been pretty critical on me and you all because of the lack of development in the third district. And, you know, Woodmar Mall's in the third district, so I'll take that criticism. It's been frustrating for all of us. I'm sure the Councilman Higgs included. But I also know part of the third district is that whole shopping plaza over by Menards over there. And since I've been mayor, almost every single inch of that entire plaza has been rebuilt. From the brand new Menards to the expansion of the round the clock. We bought a brand new restaurant over there. They opened another restaurant next door to it, Lubitos. Mm-hmm. Which is very good. And you know, there's a lot of good things happening across the city. And, you know, by the way, Root Brothers, third district. So, I mean, the fact is, I listen to criticism. That's part of being the mayor. But at the same time, you know, we want good businesses to open right next door to City Hall. We want good businesses open anywhere, and we're open for business, so.
Mayor, they did start on the second outlet, though, at Woodmar.
Yeah, they did.
So.
They did, and they're under construction as we speak.
Yeah.
It's a difficult relationship we have with that developer, as you all know.
Everybody know they did start
right.
on it.
And it's, you know, he opened up the first strip, and none of us were there to celebrate it with him just
right.
because it's such a difficult relationship. It's been a tumultuous relationship with that gentleman.
So.
Any other questions? I didn't just pick Redevelopment Commission. I'm doing this all over. I'm going to every board, every government, you know, going around just saying thanks and making sure we teach, you know, touch base together. So I appreciate you making the time for me. I congratulate all five of you. By the way, another thing that I've noticed a difference on, and I'm going to get out of here after this. When I took over as mayor, the Redevelopment Commission was like a circus. It really was. It was a board that fought with each other. You know, this board, for those of you that aren't aware, this board has five members. Three are appointed by the mayor, and two are appointed by the council. And I challenge you to figure out who is who. I challenge you. It's hard because they work together, which is how this board's supposed to work. When I took over as mayor, it was very easy to figure out who was with the mayor and who was with the council because they voted against each other all the time and they argued with each other all the time. Doesn't happen anymore. Hasn't happened almost for the last 11 years. I think you guys went literally like 6 or 7 years without a no vote. It's because you work together on these issues. And I realize no votes happen every once in a while, but when I took over as mayor, every single vote this commission took was 3-2. And every single meeting took 3 or 4 hours. And this one's gonna take 3 or 4 hours unless you get this microphone away from me, so.
I have a comment.
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
No, I wanted to thank you for seeing that everybody does work.
It's true.
Collaborates
mm-hmm.
very, very well together here.
Mm-hmm.
I think I can speak for my colleagues in saying that over the past years, we've made it a point to collaborate very, very well together.
I agree.
We did that on purpose. That wasn't, and sometimes it was really, really easy.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it was a little bit difficult, but we've always put the interest of our city and the well-being of all our constituents on every decision we've ever made in this.
Thank you very much. And, you know, the council and the mayor, we argue, but we do work together also. So it just makes sense for all of us to work together. And I know who are council appointees and mayor appointees, but I think for the general member of the public, they would have a lot of trouble figuring it out because you guys work so well together. So I want to say thank you for that as well. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you all. Have a nice day. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you everybody for giving the mayor time to speak. Number seven, conditional approval for the sale of NSP properties related affordability assistance allowance.
Mr. President, commissioners, prior to transitioning to United Neighborhoods Inc., I took the application for the acquisition of 7116 Woodlawn Avenue from Mr. Floyd Campbell. Purchase price is $97,500, and he's allowed affordability assistance allowance of up to $19,500 for this property. Mr. Campbell is present, and I'll be seeking a conditional approval for the sale of this property to him. I should add that Mr. Campbell is a City of Hammond employee. The letters have not yet been sent out, but the approval is conditional that he meets with HUD's approval to purchase the property.
So Dennis, do we have a closing date scheduled yet for this property?
Probably within the next 2 to 3 weeks. I would hope 2 weeks. Mr. Campbell.
Yes, I'd like for Mr. Campbell to come up forward.
Did your lender give you an idea as to when you might be able to close on this?
Maybe at the end of the month.
Okay.
I'm sorry, when?
In November.
End of the month.
End of the month. What, Dennis, I'm sorry, what department does Mr. Campbell work in with the city?
Public Works.
Public Works, okay. How long have you been an employee of the City of Hammond?
8 years.
8 years, okay, so you've been here for a while, that's a good thing.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion for the conditional approval for the sale of NSP properties and related affordability assistance allowance for Floyd Campbell, 7116 Woodlawn Avenue.
I second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second.
Mr. President, I would just point out that, as Mr. Radowski said, for purposes of the record, HUD requires that there be a conflict of interest inquiry that he'd have to pass. It basically states that Mr. Campbell can't be involved in the program with which he's getting assistance. Mr. Radowski will be getting me that information very shortly, so your motion and second would be conditioned upon HUD approving that conflict of interest and being able to pass that test.
So do we need to make another motion to accept under those conditions then?
Technically, if you could remove the second, and okay. Kathy could just include those comments that
okay. In her, with the condition what?
With the condition that
I need you to remove the second first.
Yeah.
I don't know who made the second.
Oh, well,
you second.
I will remove my second.
Okay, and then, Ms. Neveyaz, if you would just have your motion reflect that the approval is conditioned upon HUD approving the conflicts inquiry.
Okay, just so move. Can I?
That'd be
so
fine.
Move? Okay, so move.
And then I need a second.
I second that.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you for that clarification, Attorney Westland. Is there any more questions or discussion then on it? Okay, can we have a roll call then, please?
Yes.
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 Yes. Motion passes 5 yes.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell.
Congratulations.
Okay, number 8, approval development agreement with Byway Brewing Company, LLC, /TBD Holdings, LLC.
Mr. President, I see members of Byway Brewing Company and TBD Holdings in the audience, and they can come up to the podium, and in a second, I ask them to introduce themselves and sort of tell you about their project, but the mayor kind of alluded to it. This is a project, $2.5 to $3 million investment in the city. The developer, these three gentlemen who are Byway Brewing Company, LLC, are going to put a brew pub, tasting room/restaurant, roughly 12,000 square feet. What's up for your consideration are actually three items. Number one, the development agreement. Number two, the purchase agreement. And then thirdly, because this is in a redevelopment area, Mr. Poland is, I'm sure, chomping at the bit to come up and tell you that his findings regarding whether or not this particular development fits within the redevelopment area. And I know you have a report in your packet, but I think initially we need to take action on the development agreement and on the purchase agreement, and I'll just give you the rough strokes of those. I know they're in your packet and you've reviewed them, but as I said, it's roughly 2.5 acres, 2.37 to be exact, that are being acquired. There's about a 12,000 foot brewery, tasting room, restaurant that's going in, roughly $2 to $2.5 million, $3 million investment. What's sort of exciting about this project is this is the first, well, this developer, the incentive that they're receiving, and I saw in the paper, or Mr. McLaughlin told me what was in the paper was a little bit, partially correct but partially incorrect. The development agreement in section 1.10 calls for the incentive. It's either 1.10 or 1.11. The incentive is that the land is being sold for $336,000, which is the $142,000 an acre, which is the appraised value. And the incentive is that we are giving a forgivable promissory note to the developer, which is forgiven 20% over 5 years, 20% each year over 5 years. There's no bond sale. They haven't asked for and are not receiving, you know, any TIF financing or any sort of financing like that. What they've asked for and what staff is recommending you approve is the development agreement and the purchase agreement, which calls for the sale of the 2.37 acres at $336,000. There's $5,000 of earnest money that they're going to pay upon execution or at closing. And then the remaining portion, the $331,000, would be in a forgivable note. And there will be a note and a mortgage signed at closing. So if for any reason they weren't able to stay open for the 5 years or what have you, we would be able to recoup whatever portion is still remaining on the note. But as I said, this is the first... there's a lot of interest out there at that development, and these gentlemen have come in and said, yes, we're willing to make this investment, and all we're looking for in terms of an incentive is some help on the land sale. So I know other developments we've had, and even people that have pitched projects to us have all wanted TIF financing. So in this instance, I think this is a nice partnership for the Redevelopment Commission in the city. And with that, sort of long-winded introduction, I'll let Mr. Toth.
Mr. President, Commissioners, my name is Dave Toth. These are my partners, Tom Dzinski and Bronco Sine. And we're gonna do our best to put a great brewery, Hammond's only brewery at this point. Can't say the first because Free Floyd started here before they moved to Munster. But it will be the only one, at least for a while, because these are growing. We hope you like our project and approve it.
Would this be something like the Flossmoor station at Flossmoor?
I have no idea what they were planning. I hear it was a pretty big project, so in that regard, ours is smaller, but bigger than most of the breweries that are popping up all over the place.
They would have the brewery as well as the restaurant, correct?
Yes. Yes.
I think Mr. Toth's answer, and having written both development agreements, the big difference between the two is the footprint is a little bit smaller. They're not taking as much land, and the size of the structure that they're putting on the property is not going to be, and quite frankly, the incentive they're asking for is not going to be as large either. So it is a smaller version. It's on the north side of Carlson Drive, which would be your north west corner, or not quite to the corner, but the northwest side of Carlson Drive, which, from a planning standpoint, as far as staff is concerned, and we're all concerned, leaves us, you know, roughly 9 acres still on that side for development. And you've actually approved option agreements for professional office buildings for those other eight and a half acres. So we think this fits well with the BW3s, the Hampton. You'll have this, and then hopefully one or both of those options come through on the professional buildings, and I think you'll have a pretty nice development out there.
That's what I wanted to comment on, the potential for future tenants, them not using as much land as Flossmoor Brewery, I think is, you know, a better thing, more positive for our city to utilize the rest of the remaining outlets there.
Mr. President, fellow commissioners, I don't know if this is the right time, but I'm to bring this up. I find myself in a strange position here. I consider Mr. Toth and Mr. Sine close friends. So should I abstain, or I'm looking for a direction here.
You're not legally required, just based on a social relationship. However, if you feel that inhibits your ability to be objective on the project, that's certainly an option that you would have. So I'm not going to tell you, yeah, you have to, but I would say if it's, when you say close friends.
If I come out in favor for the project, even though I consider them friends, it's okay.
Legally, there's no problem. It's just, how are you personally?
Thank you. No financial interest, I've just known them for a long time.
I want to clear something up, too. We're going to take, one thing here at a time, because there's 8, 9, and 10. So.
Right, and I would say you need to take them in order.
We're working on number 8.
And when we get to 10, then we need to have Mr. Poland step to the...
Then, Mr. President, I'd be honored to entertain a motion for approval of a development agreement with Byway Brewing Company, LLC, /TBD Holdings, LLC.
I second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more questions or discussion? Okay, can we have a roll call then?
So, Wesley?
Yes.
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 Yes. Motion passes. 5 yes. Okay, we'll move on to number 9, approval of purchase agreement with Byway Brewing Company, LLC, /TBD Holdings, LLC.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion for the approval of the purchase agreement with Byway Brewing Company, LLC, /TBD Holdings, LLC.
I second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Once again, is there any more discussion or questions? Okay, roll call, please.
So, Presley?
Yes.
Kasperke?
Yes.
Rehas?
Yes.
Myers?
Yes.
Hawbridge?
Yes. Motion passes. 5 yes. Okay, number 10, determination of compliance for Byway Brewing Company, AKA Craft 41, 2825 Carlson Drive in Oxbow Landing, located in the Gateways redevelopment area. I would like Mr. Brian Poland to speak on that, please.
All right, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
You got a haircut.
Yes, thank you for noticing. You've gotten through 2 steps of this multi-step project, and now I'm here to talk about the 3rd step and then also explain some of the steps that will follow. First of all, I do want to point out on my report to you, there is a correction. There is some, when you type over an old document, you sometimes forget to take out the old language. So there's some extra words in the 5th line of the 1st paragraph that should be struck. In looking at the redevelopment plan, it is, first of all, at the Gateway's redevelopment area. It is also located in the East Gateway sub-area of the Gateway's redevelopment area. And we start looking at some of the goals and objectives of that redevelopment area, which are identified at the bottom of the first page of my report. But nonetheless, strengthening the corridors as commercial and service areas of the service centers and businesses of the city, enhancing and maintaining employment retention, all those, you know, wonderful economic development goals, and then, of course, encouraging diversification of commercial employment opportunities. And I think what I find interesting about this project is that it is the diversity, it is the a lot of different opportunities that opens happening, that will allows or what is going to be happening in the Oxbow area. We already have a restaurant, we already have a hotel, now we have a microbrewery, and it's really transforming this area from the former apartment complex. In other portions of the redevelopment plan, it talks about in the sub-area section that develop the area as harmonious, unified commercial retail development, and of course with the appropriate floodplain protections. And as most of us should know at this point, that the floodplain was addressed about a year ago, and this area is no longer in the floodplain. So that does really help the ability of this property to be developed. In looking at the project from a zoning perspective, the brewery component of it is something that does not normally fit in a traditional, in the C4 classification. It's the production and the distribution portion of it. So that is one of the items that will have to occur after this action by going to the Board of Zoning Appeals for a variance of use to allow the production and the distribution facility. A variance of use also requires a city council approval. The second thing is that they are proposing outdoor seating. This is a new zoning provision that we created about, I think it was just last year that got approved. So it is by the size of the number of seats and the size of the area that does require a conditional use permit. So that will be a second action by the Board of Zoning Appeals. And it would be the board's final authority. Another action that is pending is the re-subdivision of the property. The Oxbow Landing addition created everything on the north side of Carlson Drive as a large block 2. And it was done that way because we didn't know how we were going to develop this property. And as these projects are coming in, we start knowing that we have the sign parcel that we talked about, the large sign that we're constructing. And now we have this development. And so we're at an opportunity where we can start to subdivide the property, create the lots. We'll still have this large portion in the middle that's yet undefined. But you know, like I said, we can start that process, and that would, of course, affect the legal description and all the other technical things that go with that. Also in redevelopment areas, we always look at, you know, it goes back to this terminology I said earlier in the sub-area plan about the harmonious and unified development. That starts to lead into urban design and architecture. In your presentation, the elevations of the building. We've had a lot of discussions internally about that. This is actually a second version of the elevation than what was originally proposed. We've talked internally about, you know, maybe we can take it to another level, partially because when you come off the expressway, Kennedy Avenue interchange, you're looking at the north elevation, which is the top one on that page, and trying to see, you know, is there something that we're able to enhance that facade a little bit. We also recognize that that's the facade that if this particular development is successful, they want to potentially expand the building, and that would affect the style, the architecture, and the level of things that they could do to enhance that facade. But we want to look into those possibilities of trying to improve that a little bit more. The other side of it is the Carlson Drive side, the front entrance. In many of our redevelopment plans, we have a provision of 30% of the facade is masonry. It just so happens in this one, that provision is not there. But it is something that we have set a precedent for, especially with the BW3s and the hotel. All those buildings are masonry. So we want to see if we can potentially put a little bit more masonry building. That is something that we're open for discussion, and I don't want to speak too much for Phil Talon since he's not here, but we did talk about whether or not the facade program was available for that, and that was a conversation with Mr. Toth.
Yeah, I would like to see some more masonry on there, according to these drawings, but...
Right, yeah, and of course, it goes into their budget constraints and, sure, and all those types of things, and of course, we'll be willing to discuss that and strike the appropriate balance financially and incentivize it as we have what limited stuff we have available.
Maybe even, I mean, the drawings can't show that now, but even some nice, maybe neon lighting or some kind of lighting that really pops from the expressway.
I'd be a little bit careful about suggesting neon lighting, because that gets into some of our other regulatory concerns, but nonetheless.
Well, it doesn't have to be actually neon, but some kind of lighting there.
Yeah, I mean, those are the things that I think we can look at as we start going through the further review of it. I mean, the project has received substantial site plan review anyway, so there might be a few things outstanding that we can look at. Nonetheless, all that long explanation, because you always tell me I take too long to talk. But I do want to say that the proposed project is the third commercial development in recent months, and I think we're all very proud of that. And it will help to further the transformation of this area and strengthen the existing commercial hotel area south of the Borman at Kennedy Avenue. Therefore, staff recommends that the Redevelopment Commission determine that the proposed Byways Brewing Company at 2825 Carlson Drive is in compliance with the Gateway's redevelopment area subject to the four items listed. One, receiving the variance of use for the production and distribution facility from the Board of Zoning Appeals and the City Council. Two, receiving the conditional use permit for the restaurant outdoor seating from the Board of Zoning Appeals. Three, completion of the re-subdivision plat, and that's through the Plan Commission. And four, to have this further review of the design of the building and potential incentives.
I would like to make a motion to approve what Mr. Pollan just said. I would like to so move for approval.
And just for the record, that your motion would be to determine that the Byway Brewing Company project at 2825 Carlson Drive is in compliance with the Gateway redevelopment area plan, subject to the four conditions that Mr. Pollan listed.
So again, I would like to so move that motion based upon what you said, Attorney Westland.
What Dave said that I said?
The logic.
The mouthful.
I second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion or questions for Mr. Pollan?
No.
Thank you for being so thorough on your explanation.
You're welcome.
See, I appreciate that.
If I'm very thorough, then you won't ask any questions.
Thank you for clearing that up, too.
Mr. Westland.
Okay, then we'll have a roll call on that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
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 Yes. Motion passes. Five yes. Okay, thank you, and that's very good news for Byway Brewing Company. All right, we're going to move back. We had to skip number five, so we're moving back to that homebound conditional forgivable loan approval.
Commissioners, the three applicants are here. If you'd like to come up, please.
Hi, good evening. My name is Angela Rezaia.
Good evening. My name is Erica Graves.
Good evening.
Richard Foresta.
Okay, so we're going to start with the first young lady.
We have one more.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Luis Sanchez.
Thank you, and good evening.
How did you hear about the program?
Actually, my husband and I, we've been looking at homes for quite a while, and we saw a particular home online in Hammond. And with that particular home and that listing, it said, you know, the Hammond homebound program, and also with the scholarship for if you have a child. And so it was something that was of interest of us, and we currently live in Illinois, so we're first-time home buyers, and we were, you know, pretty interested in the program.
My son said, Mom, time to buy a house. I want to go to college.
He said, I'm sorry, say it again.
He said, time to buy a house. I want to go to college.
Oh.
So, and then, yeah, we looked online, and it said that the homebound program. So I looked and found some.
Either one of the gentlemen, how did you find out about the program?
Well, my, the one that's been, I was borrowing the money, the bank. The lady from the bank told us about the program. One of my co-workers had told me about it, so.
Okay. Who's your lender? Who's the bank?
Sincere.
Sincere, yeah. Okay. Makes sense. They do a lot of business like that. Okay. Well, we won't leave you out. How did you hear about the program?
I actually saw a sign about the college bound program, and I stumbled on the homebound program when I was looking into the college bound program to see the qualifications.
Okay.
I've been in Hammond my whole life. I was born in St. Margaret's. First time home buyer. Here I am.
You know, if I can make a comment, as an educator, it makes my heart feel really good that a lot of our citizens are taking advantage of this program that's going to help kind of to push our children forward so that they'll have the opportunity to go to college, because I know that otherwise it would be very, very difficult for a lot of our families. I'm very proud of the fact that our city offers that help. And congratulations to you all.
Very good comment. Well put.
Mr. President, I make a motion to approve the homebound conditional forgivable loan approval for the four applicants.
I second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the four applicants only that are present tonight.
Yeah. I'm sorry. And for the fifth applicant, I guess let me rephrase it. Mr. President, I make a motion to approve the homebound conditional forgivable loan approval for the four applicants here and for the fifth applicant on the condition that that person comes to one of our next meetings.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. We have a roll call then on that.
Soto Presley?
Yes.
Hesbricky?
Yes.
Rivejas?
Yes.
Myricks?
Yes.
Hoffridge?
Yes. Motion passes 5 yes. Thank you.
Congratulations to you all.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck.
Okay, number 11, reports. We let Mayor Tom McDermott speak earlier, so Phil Talon's not here. We're going to ask Africa if she'd like to share anything.
Sure. The mayor went over some developments that are taking place in 2014 leading into 2015, so it's a very exciting time for the city of Hammond. I also wanted to take this time to thank Byway Brewing LLC for investing in the city of Hammond. It's a wonderful dining option, and I feel that it'll be an enhancement to the Oxbow Landing area. I also want to take this time to invite everyone out to the Downtown Hammond Council's annual holiday kickoff, A Tribute to a Christmas Story, which will be held this Saturday from 10 to 4 on Holman Avenue.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I see Ms. Miller stepped out, so do you know if she has anything for us?
I don't know. I'm looking to the applicants.
Okay. We'll close on that, on our reports then. We'll move to number 12, our bills.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion to pay the register of claims for October 23rd, 2014 through November, I'm sorry, October 23rd to November 12th, 2014. Register of claims R-5-1209 through R-5-1295.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the bills. Is there any questions or discussion on the bills? Okay, roll call then.
Soto Grassley?
Yes.
Asbricky?
Yes.
Nevejas?
Yes.
Myrick?
Yes.
Hopper?
Yes, bills pass, 5 yes. Okay, number 13, new and unfinished business.
Mr. President, members of the commission, Mr. Weezer, Mr. Milbrandt, and Mr. Murphy are here and wanted to make a presentation to you, and I think the mayor referred to it briefly during his comments. And I know I'm going to get chastised for this term, but intermodal site, it's not really an intermodal site, but it's in the East Gibson Yards area. These gentlemen represent or are the developer. They're putting together a project that would consist of about 155 acres that would be a multi-tenant distribution center and railroad repair and maintenance center. So with that sort of brief introduction, I know Mr. Weezer wanted to sort of give you the opportunity to give you the introduction to the project. And at some point here in the not too distant future, we should have a development agreement in your upcoming meetings for your consideration.
Okay, I'd like to welcome Mr. Jim Weezer, if you could come forward. And
thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and members of the Redevelopment Commission. If you don't mind, we have a few, or it's all the same handout, and there we only had four additional copies, so if someone could share, I'd appreciate it. Real quickly, my name is Jim Weezer. I'm an attorney with offices at 429 West Lincoln Highway in Schererville, and I'm the attorney for this particular project and the attorney for the developers. And as David mentioned, I have here with me this evening two of the principals of the developer. The developer is called Throughport Intermodal LLC, and that's Justin Murphy, who's the CEO, and Russ Milbrandt, who's a longtime, well-known attorney and businessman from the Valparaiso area, and they're the two of the principals. Let me just give you a brief overview. And the whole idea was that this is a project that's been discussed with the city and with staff members and great discussions over a significant period of time, because it involved the acquisition of some property and some other issues. And currently, as David said, he and I have been working on a development agreement that is substantially done and substantially completed. But we thought it was important to at least introduce this project to you tonight, just to give you an overview. Not realizing the mayor intended to do that on his own, so he did a pretty good job. But I'll just try to hone in on a couple of things very, very quickly for you. As Dave said, this is in the East Gibson Yard area. So the project is bounded, just to kind of give you a general idea. It's bounded on the north by US 12 or Michigan. It's bounded on the west by Kennedy Avenue. Bounded on the east by Klein, and on the south by three railroads. So it's obviously the northern portion of the Hessville area of Hammond. Quite honestly, it's particularly it's of a particular importance to me as someone who's born and raised in Hammond and went to school about 5 or 6 blocks south of where this project is, at least grade school, went there. And so I'm really honored, quite frankly, to be part of this project, having been born and raised here. But as David said, it's a total of 155 acres. And you'll get an opportunity to look at those documents that we gave to you, the description. But basically, what we're doing, it has a lot of the elements of a true intermodal site, but it doesn't quite meet the total definition of an intermodal site. It's really a site that provides for warehousing, distribution centers, and sort of a logistics site. And one of the uses is going to be as a railroad car repair center. The folks that are involved in that particular project, who have entered into a letter of intent in preparation for a lease of the property, this will be only the third railroad repair site in the United States. And it'll be the first and only one with double tracking, which means a lot to the guys from the railroads. Doesn't mean a whole lot to me, but it means a lot to the guys from the railroads because of the ability to repair more cars more quickly, more trains more quickly. And it provides for utilization by Class 1 railroads, which is really significant, and takes advantage of the infrastructure that this city has to offer. Really takes advantage of the railroad and the railroad trackage and the railroad traffic. As far as the distribution centers, we're talking about distribution centers for a market, and we've got it. Dave and I have been working on a description of the project that's part of what you'll get as your development agreement very, very soon, I'm sure. And as we put in the description of the project, I think this is significant. It says, Thruport will become a major distribution center for a large portion of the central United States for frozen beef, chicken, turkey, pork, and other types of frozen foods. That are going to be able to be processed and distributed from there. And as we also said, there's segments of the rail transport market currently underserved, including mid-sized and smaller load customers with high-value perishable refrigerated products from around the world. And in order to do this, and I'm not going to get into the technical aspect of this, because I couldn't possibly do that, but the one company has a transloader. They call it a transloader to be able to move very quickly, efficiently, and effectively the product from the railroad, from the cars to trucks to be shipped. And it's a new system, very creative, and really speeds up the process so that you can use. Previously, the railroads just weren't available to get it done quickly enough. Now they can get it done quickly enough by loading it onto the semi-trucks and having it distributed. So let me hit the key things for you real quickly here. We look at doing this project in several phases. And it's a major project. So obviously, when you get the development agreement, you'll see that there are certain incentives that we seek, and one incentive is TIF financing. The TIF financing is based upon reports that and analysis that were prepared by Carl Sender and Company, and we'll go into certainly more detail when we are prepared and are here to discuss the development agreement and that report. But we see it happening in two phases. The first phase would be the railroad car repair. They are ready to go. The company is out of, and you'll see it in your information, the company is out of Florida. It's called Reliable Rail Services. And they would repair and maintain, coal, grain, and tank cars owned by railroad utilities. And they will also, and this is really from a railroad perspective, kind of a unique aspect, they're also intending to do the maintenance of locomotives at that site, which is really unique and very difficult to do, and which will make this center unbelievably attractive to Class I railroads as a result of that. We believe that business will employ at least 50 people to start up. The second phase of the project would be the cold storage and dry warehousing. We already have potential users. We're always looking for more because there's a lot of acreage there, and that is really going to be the hub of the operation, and it's very important. It's proposed that one warehouser would have about a 250,000 square foot warehouse, and that would be what is going to be utilized or used by the transloader operation. We believe these businesses, the initial businesses there for warehousing, the railroad transloader operation, in discussions with those representatives, will employ 30 or more people, and then the warehousing itself, the initial warehousing users, will employ between 120 and 150 employees. So all told, once we get phase one and phase two initially up and operating, we would start with a minimum, we believe, of 230 jobs, new jobs, located in the city of Hammond, and obviously would be developed and would the people be employed consistent with what the mayor said before, you know, trying to ensure that Hammond residents get their fair opportunity to be those employees or among those employees. So it's really an exciting project. It's a large project. It's an incredible investment into the community with an unbelievable return, because what we're talking about, as I described initially, is really just the tip of the iceberg. If this really takes off, there's a lot of land there that could be developed for that purpose that has laid dormant for a long time, which obviously goes back onto the tax rolls, which greatly enhances the assessed valuation of the area and the community, and we're very, very excited about it. If you have any initial questions that we can answer, we'll be happy to do that, but as David mentioned, we should be back here hopefully very shortly. I would guess, at least my review of the last draft that Dave and I went over, the agreement's probably about 90% or more completed and should be finalized and ready to be submitted to you within the next week or so. So, but we stand ready, any one of us here, to answer any questions that you may have.
I'll just comment again, you couldn't ask for a better spot for this type of business. Yeah. To utilize that land there, you know, being a railroad yard there, and I think there's a couple other little trucking outfits as you pull into there too, so it is a very good fit.
Yes, we believe that it is. And now that Michelle's back, I can repeat everything that I just said, so get it.
And you, one more thing too, Jim, you did answer, I was going to ask you about employees, but you did. I appreciate the thing on the employees.
Yeah, we think that's a real key to this whole project. Okay, well, thank you very much for your
time. I'm sorry, Matt, if I'd be so kind, if you'd be so kind. It sounds, of course, we know the area, and it's great for that. Is that going to be a neg? I'm a guy from North Hammond where we deal with trains a lot. Is that going to increase truck and train traffic noticeably?
Well, it certainly is going to increase traffic, but the way that it's designed, and Justin knows a lot more about that than I do, it won't cause difficulties or problems because of the interstate system. Trucks will be coming off of Klein Avenue onto Michigan, and they won't go, when they come on, they'll enter on Kennedy Avenue, but they won't go, they can't come into Hessville, they won't go any farther, but I'll let Justin touch on that for
I think he
a
just
second.
He just answered it. Okay. We're, one of the most attractive things about the site is the location to the highways. The toll roads, Frisbee Throw to the north of the property, Klein Avenue is adjacent to us on the east side of the property. All of our truck traffic will come off of Klein Avenue onto 20. It'll enter the property off of the top side of 20. One of the things that we've asked you as an incentive is to help us put a red light on 20. As you may know, there's that sharp curve right there. As you come off of Kennedy and you're going towards Klein, we've had numbers of car accidents there at that sharp curve. We've asked the city to work with NDOT to put a red light there. we will have the majority of the warehouse traffic enter the property there, so it'll never touch Hessville. We will have traffic for the repair center come in past Central Rent-A-Crane, but then otherwise turn into the property there. We'll never cross the bridge by the IHB down by Chuck and Irene's. We'll never cross the bridge. We'll never bring truck traffic into the neighborhood, so it should have absolutely no effect. I live in Hessville. I mean, I know my neighbors would be irate too. We made that commitment 2 years ago to the city in the initial planning. Otherwise, all the train traffic's there. That's a CSX track. You have both NS and CSX, so we have two class ones. We plan on fixing class one trains. We're going to bring in entire unit trains. The entire train will come into the property, and we'll fix it that way. One of the things he did mention of the unit train centers, there's one in Kansas right now. Ours will be the second, I believe, in the United States. We'll be the only one with two loops being able to handle two trains simultaneously. So that's what we're looking to do to make sure that there's no negative effect with regard to traffic. It's all positive to us. We're at the throat of Chicago. We can't get any closer to bring warehouses in. As you may know, all the intermodal sites over in Chicago, there's approximately 32. They're then built out as far away as Joliet, where they can find enough land mass to build a facility. And so here, Hammond, sitting at the throat of Chicago, we're not an hour, hour and a half away like Joliet is. So that's one of the reasons why the site's so attractive to us.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, well, thank you very much for your time. We appreciate it, and we'll hope to be back here real soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Okay, is there any more new and unfinished business? All right, number 14, public comment. If anybody like to come forward and speak, you have 3 minutes. Just introduce yourself. Public comment closed. Number 15, adjournment, do we?
Mr. President, I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Can you all signify by saying aye?
Aye.
Ayes have it. Meeting adjourned.